Today we're going to look at 4.5 diode tricks that you can use in your designs. The diode is a fundamental component you have to understand if you want to grow your electronics prowess. So today we're going to take a quick look at what a diode is, then look at 4.5 uses for a diode in your designs, but we're not going to use half a diode. Anyways, diodes are generally the first nonlinear component one learns about. Resistors, capacitors, and inductors are all linear devices, meaning that if you were to plot the input voltage versus the output voltage, you'd get a plot straight up and to the right. Nonlinear devices don't follow Ohm's law, and for circuit analysis, you cannot replace them with a Thevenin equivalent. Diodes are also passive devices, which means they don't need power to function. Finally, they are two-port devices, meaning there's just one input, the anode, and one output, the cathode. When operating normally, an ideal diode only conducts current in one direction. They're conceptually quite simple, but are extremely useful because of their VI curve, which looks like this. The x-axis is voltage, and the y-axis tells us how much current can flow through the device when exposed to that level of voltage. At moderate positive voltages, a diode essentially acts as a short, but with a small voltage drop called the forward voltage drop. You can see the forward voltage drop on the VI curve, usually around 0.6 or 0.7 volts, and that's where the current starts to ramp up. That 0.6, 0.7 volt drop is standard for silicon diodes, but for other types of diodes and materials, this forward voltage drop may vary. You can measure this forward drop using a multimeter with a built-in diode testing capability. And you can see that this diode has a forward voltage of roughly 0.62 volts. The forward voltage is also sometimes called the cut-in voltage or the on voltage, but what you need to remember is that when exposed to a moderate voltage, say 5 volts, a diode will pass through 5 volts minus the forward voltage, so 4.3 volts for a standard silicon diode. There are some methods for compensating for this drop, but that's beyond the scope of today's video. When exposed to a negative voltage, there will be a nanoamp reverse current, or current from the cathode to the anode, that you can generally take to be 0 amps in most situations. That is, until you get to the other big swing on the VI curve, known as the breakdown voltage. If your diode is exposed to this level of reverse bias, you blew it, often literally. Diodes essentially can't hold up to that level of negative voltage stress, and the device literally breaks down, allowing negative current to flow. Long story short, you can essentially think of a diode as a one-way conductor. So, enough preface, let's look at a few different ways you can use diodes for your circuits. Rectifiers. This has been covered ad nauseum by other channels, so I'm going to cover this quickly. The gist is that you can let through the positive voltages from an AC source while blocking or inverting the negative ones. You can put together a half-wave rectifier with a single diode, a full bridge rectifier with 4 diodes. That's right, it's not a dumb single diode rectifier, it's a full bridge. It's worth noting that you have to use a differential probe to measure a full bridge rectifier with a scope to avoid grounding half your rectifier. Bring a capacitor into the mix and you can do a couple things. First, you can smooth out your waveform. So here I have my half bridge rectifier and I have a capacitor on a switch. And when I switch in that capacitor, you can see that my ripple has gone down significantly and my rectified signal is much smoother. Second, you can build a voltage multiplier, which is essentially just a bunch of half-wave rectifiers in series. This is used for things that need high voltage but not a lot of current, like electric bug zappers and particle accelerators, which are basically the same thing, right? Rectifiers are also the backbone of original AM radios. Diode logic gates. You can build simple logic gates using diodes. You can create an N input OR gate or AND gate using one diode per input. For more practical scenarios, you can do some less standard logic. Take, for example, a battery backup system. Using two diodes, you can pass either the intended voltage input, if present, or the battery source. In this situation, the diode is reverse biased under normal conditions, so the battery stands dormant. When the source voltage is removed, the diode becomes forward biased and provides power to the device. Diode clamps. You can use diodes to limit the range of a signal. You can essentially pre-clip the signal by connecting a diode to a reference voltage or a voltage divider. If we start with a standard triangle wave, the signal looks normal on the scope. But when we add the diode and resistor clamp attached to a positive voltage reference, the signal starts to clamp. If I adjust the reference voltage, we'll see the clamping levels start to change. So when I'm low, there's no clamping, and as I get to higher voltage levels, we can see the clamping at the top of the screen. You could do the same thing for negative voltages also. If you want to get better clamping, you can add a bypass capacitor, or you could turn to an active clamper circuit using an op-amp or transistor circuit. But the simple diode provides an easy and cheap clamp. They're often used with sensitive inputs like CMOS logic circuits to prevent damage from static discharge. Clamps can also provide DC restoration when used with a capacitor. For example, if a signal has been capacitively coupled, you could set up a diode and a capacitor like this to restore its positive DC component. Channel 1 is the input, and you can see it's centered right around ground, and channel 2 is the output, which you can see is now bottoming out around ground. It's been DC rectified. Diode limiters. I'm only counting this as half of a use because it technically falls under clamping, but it is different enough to warrant that extra 0.5. Limiters, sometimes known as clippers, are a special type of clamp that limit the output to plus or minus the forward voltage with a setup like this, which can be used to help protect high gain amplifiers or other sensitive circuitry from saturating. So right now I just have a AC modulated signal going into my scope. Now watch what happens if we sweep the input amplitude between 0 and 5 volts and connect the signal up to our limiter. And you can now see that my voltage peak to peak doesn't swing beyond plus 0.8 volts or minus 0.8 volts, which is essentially the forward voltage of these diodes. Flyback diodes. Flyback diodes are the pressure release valves of the electronics world. Because inductors resist a change in current, you can't just instantaneously turn them off. They'll fight back against the control circuitry to the point that it can shorten its life or blow it up altogether. This is known as an inductive kick. So you can add a flyback diode in parallel with the inductor. As I mentioned in the video about the time constant, this can cause a slower current decay than you might like, so you could also use an RC snubber if you prefer. It also won't work if the inductor is driven by an AC source, like a transformer, because the diode will conduct on half cycles. In that situation, you should use an RC snubber or something like a metal oxide varistor. To learn more, check out the component testing with an oscilloscope app note in the description that discusses how to test both linear and nonlinear devices using an oscilloscope. Are you using any of these tricks in your designs? Let me know in the comments or on Twitter. And if you like this video, be sure to give it a big thumbs up, subscribe to the Keysight Labs YouTube channel, and hit that little alarm bell to make sure you're getting a notification when we upload a new video. Thanks for watching. I'm Daniel Bogdanoff, and I'll see you next time. Flyback diodes, yep. Caw-caw.